It is really an honor for me for delivering this talk and inaugurating the tech room today. I am really thankful to the society, the principal, the chairman, and all the members, board members, and students for inviting me and giving me opportunity to express my views with regard to the topic which we will be dealing with, criminal law, mostly the bail and arrest. Friends, I am really happy that there are many students who are coming for this profession, and they are deciding it at very young age, means from the school days or even at the time of passing of the school 10th or 12th standard. The 5 years course started here or all over India is a boom for entire judiciary also. I will give my experience about this, because in our days there was no 5 years course. We were having only 3 years course. I think most of us who did LLB at that time must be knowing about it. And it was practically, it was just one another degree to be obtained if you are not engaged in any other profession or service. As far as myself is concerned, I landed in law college because my mother wanted that I should be a lawyer. And secondly, since I was interested in sports, so those 3 years additional benefit to play and to represent the college and the school and the university was again an opportunity for me. But frankly speaking, when I landed in law school and when we start learning the niceties of this particular profession or law, then I realized that there is lot of scope for all of us to go into this profession. The constitution, the laws in India are so beautifully drafted, though it is most of things are coming from the British era, but the customs which were there in India have been adopted in our laws. As Mr. Pandey has already mentioned, that we are civilized persons and democratically ruled persons from ages together. So when I passed out LLB, then I realized that something has to be looked forward, and we should help the society and give back to the society what we can do our best. So for students, I will just request that don't take it as only one of the course or a degree in your hand, but this is a tool by which you can give at the most service to the society and to the people who are in need of legal services. Now, when you go to the courts, I know that most of the students must be visiting the courts in your curriculum or for the purpose of learning the niceties. So please try to understand that theoretical knowledge which is taught in the court, in the colleges and other classes is, no doubt it is necessary, but for the students, learning experience comes only in courts. So it is my request to all of you that whenever you get time, you please go to any court and mostly to the trial courts to learn basic things such as the procedural laws, how the CPC works, how CRPC works and how the witnesses are examined. That things will, that knowledge will give you the first hand experience in your entire career in future. Mr. Pandey has already mentioned about the ethics. So that is the place for you to learn ethics also. When you go to the courts, to the bar rooms, and go to the offices of some lawyers, then you understand how the things move and how the arguments are advanced in the court. No doubt we are burdened with lot of dockets, but still we have to manage it, whatever available with us. Mr. Kunkalikar has already mentioned about the technology aspects. Now you must be knowing about artificial intelligence, ChatGPT, that all these things are coming up. But my sincere advice to you, that don't be a slave to the technology. No doubt you have to take the advantage of that, but go to the root of the matter. Please read the books. The commentaries which are available in the libraries, court libraries are there, the college libraries are there, which will give you the thorough knowledge of the procedures, of the laws, and of the particular aspect of the field. So friends, when you go to the court, please try to learn and take notes so that you will understand how the procedure is adopted. Now, the topic which is given to me for this lecture is a vast topic. I will not be able to cover the entire thing, but I will try to say a few things which are very much important with regard to the arrest, bail, and other elements of the criminal system. Now, why the arrest is required? So many persons or so many suspects, they consider that I have not done anything, why my arrest is required? I will cooperate with the police, why I should be placed in a police station or in a judicial lockup? The system works for the betterment of both the suspect as well as for the victims. Now you all know, you must have learned about the Civil Procedure Code. Basic thing is Section 41 of the CRPC deals with the aspect of arrest and the powers of the police officer to arrest any person who is suspected to have committed the offence. Now here, if there is a reasonable complaint filed or a credible information received or a reasonable suspicion exists, then only the person could be arrested, and that too in respect of a cognizable offence. You must be knowing that there are two types. One is non-cognizable offence and the other is cognizable offence. In non-cognizable offences, there is no question of arrest. But in cognizable offences, where the police can take cognizance and file FIR and investigate the matter, the arrest is necessary for few reasons. First of all, to prevent such person from committing further offence, for a proper investigation, to prevent such person from causing the evidence of the offence to disappear or tampering with the evidence in any manner, to prevent such person from making any inducement, threat, promise to person who is acquainted with the facts of the case, and so on. The police officer has to consider that whether the arrest is important or necessary. Now, in 2010, the important provision has been added in CRPC, that is Section 41A, which bifurcates the offences below, the punishment is below 7 years and above 7 years. Now, this provision has been incorporated only to see that whenever the arrest is not required, it should not be done only on mechanical basis. So the police officer is duty bound to find out whether such arrest is important or whether it could be curtailed. The discretion is given, however, that has to be exercised judiciously. Even the police officer has to record reasons for the purpose of arrest when the offence is punishable below 7 years. This provision has been incorporated only to see that our jails are not clogged or more accommodated with more people there and languishing in jail. Now, sometimes the arrest is also important when the offender is a proclaimed offender and he is evading arrest, he is not coming to the court. There are matters pending against him in various courts and he is not attending those matters. So there is a delay in conducting those trials. In such case, the arrest is required. Now, when the arrest is carried out, we all know that the provisions of Article 21 and 22 of the Constitution of India comes into play. Here, safeguards are provided to the person who is arrested. He has to be medically examined. He has to be produced. He is required to be produced before the magistrate within a period of 24 hours. Secondly, he is to be allowed to be consulted with a legal practitioner of his choice. Then intimation has to be given to his near relatives about the arrest, including the grounds of arrest, so that he can take recourse for filing of the bail applications. The embargo to arrest such person in respect of the offences referred is provided under the provisions of CRPC as well as in the Constitution. So it is the duty of police officer as well as the magistrate before whom the accused is produced within a period of 24 hours to verify, peruse all the case papers and mostly the case diaries, and to find out whether such arrest or such further custody of such person is necessary. If the magistrate comes to the conclusion that custody of that person suspected is not required further, he can inform the accused that he is entitled for bail, or at the most, in the meantime, refer him to a judicial custody. Now, the purpose of police custody is having also importance. Normally, the police custody is granted for a few reasons: to find out the weapon which is used while committing the offence, to find out the stolen property, or other cases where the accused is not helping the prosecution or the investigating officer. Now, these things you will learn only when you go to the court and find out how the remand applications are filed, how the remands are granted, how the judicial custody is granted to an accused,
and what is the period of it. Now, second thing is regarding bail, there are two different criteria. One is bailable offences and second are non-bailable offences. Now, in bailable offences, the accused is having a right to be granted bail when he says that I want bail. So there is no choice for the magistrate also, and to once bail bonds are furnished, the person has to be released. The second category comes with the aspect of non-bailable offences. Here there is a discretion with the court whether to grant bail or to refuse it. Now this discretion also has to be exercised very judiciously and by looking into all the aspects of the allegations made as well as the concept of bail is a rule and jail is an exception. We all know that our jail all over India are full with the accused persons. In most of the areas, even the capacity is double the amount of the actual capacity in jail. However, it is not because they are refused bail. The question is here that the offences are reported and the people are having faith in the judiciary, and therefore the crime rate is also increasing. You know that there are now new type of offences are coming up, which we call it cyber offences. Sometimes there are no boundaries or no jurisdictions with regard to such type of offences. A person sitting abroad is with the help of internet, he is hacking a computer or your mobile phone at anywhere. So the complaint is filed and then the question of jurisdiction comes. So that is separate topic itself. But it is not like that bail is not granted by the courts. In most of the matters, bail is routinely granted. But when the offences are very serious, in that case, in that type of scenario, the bail applications are required to be rejected. The purpose of rejection of bail is also required to be kept in mind. The first thing is that the accused should be available for the purpose of trial. The second is that he should not, by going out, try to influence the witnesses and mostly the victim. We have seen in our experience that in most of the heinous offences, such like murder, rape and other, the accused, if he is released on bail, the first thing he is doing is that going to the victim, his family members, the witnesses, and try to threaten them or try to pressurize them emotionally or otherwise, and asking them not to depose against him in the court. The disadvantage of this is that when the witness comes to the court, he is in a dilemma. So that proper justice is not given to the victim also and to the family members. In such type of cases, it is the duty of the court also to see that the accused, even if granted bail, should not indulge in this type of activities. Now friends, when we talk about bail, there are lot of material which you will be getting on internet as well as in the law books. To find out, there are lot of judgments on each topic. My experience as a session judge also and as now as a high court judge also, that each and every case is having something different in it. You cannot compare each case or earlier cases with the present cases. So while applying law laid down by the Supreme Court, by the high courts, you should not just go and find out what is the ratio, but you have to find out what are the facts in those matters. So we have to have that balancing act. Sometimes it is very difficult. Sometimes you have to carve out something which is not there in the earlier cases and then come to the conclusion. We as judges don't claim that we are right always. We also commit mistakes. But the fact is that there should be frankness in accepting that there is a mistake. Nobody in this world is perfect in all respect. Everybody as a human being commit mistake at one and the other point of time. The best thing is that you have to accept your own mistake, try to correct it and go forward. That is the part of life which we try to inculcate in our society itself. Now, the other thing is how to learn about the law. I know that your principal and teachers here are well versed. They give you all the theoretical knowledge. But the best thing to know and to understand how the system works is to attend the courts. You can attend a chamber of a lawyer also, and whenever possible go to the courts and try to find out, question your seniors, get the knowledge and then learn about all these things. I will advise all young students here to try and devote most of your time in learning process. Still at this age or at this stage, I am also learning from young lawyers who are appearing before us and getting knowledge from them. That is the process. Till you die, you have to learn. There is no escape from this. You cannot claim that I am perfect, but try to learn because there are new things are coming up. So everybody has to be in the learning mode. I am really fortunate that most of my judicial career I spent in Margao or South Goa. So I know the young lawyers who are appearing and who are coming from this college itself, who appeared before me and argued the matters very nicely to the point. And I know most of these lawyers who are appearing in South Goa, there are few are here with present today, and I know and I am sure that the young lawyers present here or young students present here, they will be good lawyers and helping the society in future also. I thank Mr. Kunkolikar and all the board members for giving me this opportunity, inviting me here and having an interaction with the young students. Thank you very much.
तुम पाहतात GNH.